So I work in theoretical computer science, in particular in algorithm design, and specifically on so-called sublinear algorithms.
This is Michael Kapralov, an assistant professor of the IC School at EPFL, and today we're going to discuss a particularly brilliant sublinear algorithm that will likely have huge applications in the years to come. But first, what's a sublinear algorithm?
So these are algorithms that are designed for handling massive data sets, and they often run in time smaller than the dataset itself, or use memory that is smaller than the dataset itself, or use communication smaller than the dataset itself.
And as you've guessed, such sublinear algorithms are going to play a crucial role in the upcoming age of big data. They are basically the way to get the best out of a big data set without having to spend a lot of time and energy passing through all of the data of the big data sets.
I think it's a very exciting field because it's sort of the perfect place to apply mathematics to problems that arise in the real world and design interesting theoretical solutions that also have potential for impact.
In particular, what might be the crowning achievement of sublinear algorithm design so far is probably the Sparse Fourier Transform. But to understand the Sparse Fourier Transform, we should probably first discuss the Discrete Fourier Transform and the Fast Fourier Transform.
The Discrete Fourier Transform is fundamental to many questions in science and technology, and naturally we want to be able to compute the Discrete Fourier Transform fast.
Let's see how fast a naive implementation of the Discrete Fourier Transform is. So we have a signal of length n. This signal is going to have a Fourier transform that's made of n Fourier coefficients. Now, to compute each of these coefficients, we need to make a linear combination of all the inputs of the original signal. This means that we need to compute n Fourier coefficients, each of which requires a computation time of the order of n. Thus, a naive implementation of the discrete Fourier transform will require an n square computation time. It's not slow, but it's not fast. If n is about a billion, which corresponds to gigabytes of data, this will take years to perform on a laptop like mine. Fortunately, then came the Fast Fourier Transform.
So the FFT algorithm, which is the Fast Fourier Transform algorithm, has led to a revolution in digital signal processing.
We discussed the huge variety of applications of the Fourier Transform in a previous video. Not so surprisingly, this has led some computer scientists to dub the FFT the most important numerical algorithm of our lifetime.
The Fast Fourier Transform itself, this classical algorithm of Cooley and Tukey from 1964, which was probably also known to Gauss in 1805.
Yeah, Gauss. He got there 150 years before anybody else.
Basically, this is an exact algorithm for computing the Fourier Transform, and in a sense, it's somewhat algebraic in nature. It really exploits the numerical properties of the length of the signal that we're working with. Sort of the fastest implementations that we have are for signals that are powers of two. So this is a very clever way of doing a form of divide and conquer. One observes that if we want to perform a Fourier transform of a length n signal, because of the nature of the problem, it turns out that we can basically split the signals into two halves, do the Fourier transform of the two halves, and then combine them in an efficient manner. So, given a length n signal, this halving process lets us compute the Fourier transform in a recursive manner in log n levels. And this divide and conquer approach basically gives us the n log n algorithm.
This approach shares strong resemblance with fast sorting algorithms like quicksort and merge sort. Now, it's hard to imagine how we could do better than that. After all, there are n Fourier coefficients, so simply writing them all down will take at least n computation steps. However, as we've discussed it in a previous video, we usually don't take the Fourier transform of any signal. In fact, if you want to compute the Fourier transform of a signal, it's probably because its Fourier representation is nice in some way. In particular, we're usually not interested in all of the Fourier coefficients. We're usually only interested in the dominant Fourier coefficients. And this has motivated the quest for a sublinear Fourier transform.
So the question on sparse Fourier transform algorithms is the following. We have a signal of length n. We don't want the entire Fourier transform, however. We have a small number k of dominant coefficients that we want to extract. we're happy to tolerate some approximation, and we want to extract these k dominant Fourier coefficients very fast. What I mean when I say when very fast, I mean that I want to run in time proportional to the number of coefficients that I want to extract. Maybe times some weak dependence on the length of the original signal. So one should think of, say, the ideal runtime would be k log n. Imagine the FFT runtime of n log n, just replace the length of the signal n with k, the number of dominant coefficients.
So intuitively, k log n should be a lower bound on the computation time required to compute the k dominant Fourier coefficients.
The current approaches don't quite give this runtime, but they come fairly close. So for instance, the best-known runtime for sparse FFT, which is due to the work of Hassanieh, Indyk, Katabi, and Price from a few years ago, achieves the runtime of k log squared n. And the interesting part about this is that this is sublinear runtime in the length of the input signal. So if k is very small, so think of maybe I want the constant number of dominant coefficients, then this algorithm runs in time about log squared n. So it doesn't even look at the entire signal.
Wow, this is very impressive. But how? How does the sparse Fourier transform work?
In effect, the way the sparse FFT algorithms work is basically by designing these clever hashing primitives. That is, the algorithmic techniques that go into sparse FFT algorithms, they basically are a blend, a very interesting blend, of techniques that come from theoretical computer science, such as, say, hashing and randomized algorithms, and classical signal processing techniques, say, the idea of filtering.
Let's dig a little bit into the details.
The main idea behind sparse FFT algorithms is to implement a hashing scheme in Fourier domain. So what you do is you permute the input signal in Fourier domain, and we permute them uniformly at random. This means that these dominant k coefficients basically end up fairly uniformly spread over the frequency domain. Then we design a hashing scheme, namely a partitioning scheme of the Fourier domain into buckets, about k buckets if we had k dominant coefficients. In this case, it turns out that every bucket contains about one coefficient most of the time, which is why we're able to solve the problem. So basically, we're able to isolate the coefficients in a certain sense. And sort of the main question and the main challenge in designing sparse Fourier transform algorithms is exactly in designing these efficient hashing schemes. And so at the moment, we have very good results for this classical, under this classical assumption that the spectrum is dominated only by k non-zero frequencies.
This is very impressive. You can now extract most of the frequency information of any signal without having to pass all of the signal. You can do it in sublinear time. And yet, the sparse Fourier transform may not quite be the final answer in Fourier transform computation research.
In fact, when we think about efficiency of sparse Fourier transform algorithms, it is good to measure them along two axes. If one is the obvious one, which is how fast do they run. So this k log squared that I mentioned is the currently best known result. On the other hand, sparse Fourier transform coefficients, sparse Fourier transform algorithms also have this other important efficiency parameter, which is sample complexity.
The sample complexity is the number of bits of the input signal you're going to have a peak at.
So this comes back to this application in medical imaging that I mentioned, to magnetic resonance imaging, where I have an input signal, and I get to measure the Fourier coefficients of that signal, then I want to reconstruct it. Sort of the sample complexity of a sparse Fourier transform algorithm is the number of points that I need to measure at in order to reconstruct my original signal.
In other words, you can now think of the input signal as some highly complex physical object you want to study, and having any kind of measurement of this highly complex physical object could be costly both in terms of time and money. Then, rather than minimizing the computation time, which may not be quite of an issue in this case, you might want to minimize the sample complexity, that is, the number of measurements you need to make to extract the k-dominant Fourier coefficients.
So this is a very important parameter to optimize because this basically translates into measurement complexity of medical imaging processes. So at the moment, we have very good algorithms under the classical assumption that the only thing that I know about the spectrum of the signal is how many non-zeros it has. So we know by the result that I mentioned that we can reconstruct the top coefficients in k-log squared time, and that this is a different result by myself and others, that we can reconstruct the dominant k coefficients by using k-log n samples of the input signal, which turns out to be optimal.
So in the last 5 years, theoretical computer scientists, including Michael Kapralov, have successfully designed an algorithm for Fourier transform that's near optimal in terms of computation time, and a Fourier transform algorithm that's near optimal in terms of sample complexity. Could we now combine these two to make an algorithm that's optimal in both metrics?
So the two results that I mentioned about minimizing sample complexity and runtime complexity, these are actually two distinct algorithms. So the best known result for runtime achieves about k-log squared and runtime and the same sample complexity. The best known result for sample complexity achieves k-log n samples, which is optimal, but runs in time linear in the length of the signal. So as of now, we don't really have the ideal algorithm that we would like to have. It's not clear if that is possible, is can we reconstruct the dominant k coefficients of the signal in time k log n. We know that we cannot do any better than that, and this would be the holy grail. This would close the problem under the classical assumption. We're not quite there yet, and so there's some still more exciting algorithmic techniques to be developed. Now, in this talk, I'm interested in graphs that are so large that we're unable to fit the set of edges of the graph into the memory of our computer. The signals that actually arise in practice, they're not only sparse, that they satisfy further structural constraints.